नहीं, अभी मैंने फिर रीज्वाइन किया है।
ओके
अच्छा, हाय मैम।
गुड इवनिंग,
हेलो।
वेलकम टू सेकेंड लेक्चर ऑफ आई फोकस. दिस इज ऑल अबाउट विजन. विजन इज द मेजरेबल फंक्शन ऑफ द आई एंड इट्स द मोस्ट इम्पॉर्टेंट एस्पेक्ट ऑफ ऑप्थल्मोलॉजी. एंड द टॉक टुडे इज ऑल अबाउट विजन, विजुअल एक्यूटी असेसमेंट एंड कॉन्ट्रास्ट सेंसिटिविटी. आई वेलकम प्रोफेसर शीतल साहू टू डिलीवर द लेक्चर, बिफोर विच मृतिका विल इंट्रोड्यूस हर.
हेलो, आई एम ऑडिबल सर। So today the lecture is by Dr. Sheetal Sahu. She's a professor at Gyanapoya Medical College, and she has several publications to her name and is an excellent teacher. So we are all looking forward to her lecture. Without further ado, let's start with that. It's all about the vision, visual assessment, as well as contrast sensitivity.
Good evening, everyone. At the outset, I would like to thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity. We test vision day in and day out, but many a times it so happens we really don't observe, the details of what we are doing. Sometimes we don't discuss it in detail. So, in today's class, that's what I'm going to do.
Ma'am, just share your screen.
Yeah, I'll just do that.
Yes, ma'am, it's visible.
It's all right now?
Yeah.
Go to show slide. Perfect.
So at the end of this session, you will be able to understand the principle of Snellen's and LogMAR visual acuity testing and know important differences between them. And then understand the principle behind various methods of assessment of visual acuity in children in different age groups, and recognize the importance of contrast sensitivity and understand the principle behind testing it. So today is going to be a basics and concepts class. Now, it's very important to understand that vision is not equal to visual acuity. Visual acuity is just one amongst the many components of vision. It can be measured easily. It only quantifies high contrast vision loss. Let me repeat, high contrast vision loss. Therefore, it does not tell one about the quality of vision. So if you look at the figure on the right side, you can see that there are so many components to vision: visual acuity, visual field, contrast, stereopsis, color vision. So there's so much to vision. Now, the basic thing to understand here is the visual angle. So the visual angle is the angle subtended at the nodal point of the eye by an object in the visual field. The importance of the visual angle in visual field is because it refers to, just a second, yeah. Because it refers to this spatial limit of visual discrimination. Visual angle, let me repeat this again, visual angle helps to specify the spatial extent of vision. So there are some terms we need to familiarize ourselves with. Minimum visible means detecting the presence or absence of stimulus. Resolution of vision means to identify the spatial characteristics of the target. And finally, recognition means resolution plus cognition. That is, you have to identify it with memory. For example, recognition of faces. So what you have to understand here is recognition is more than resolution, which has a cognitive component to it. So minimum angle of resolution. So if two points can be recognized as separate, when they subtend an angle of 1 minute of an arc at the nodal point of the eye. So you can see that in this diagram on the left. So if you want to see these two dots as separate, then they must form an angle of 1 minute at the nodal point of the eye. And also at the receptor level, there should be one unstimulated cone in between two stimulated cones. So visual acuity tests in infants check only resolution and not recognition. Therefore, amblyopia can go undetected. Now, something about what we see day in and day out, the Snellen's acuity chart. So how many of us have really bothered to keenly observe it? So let me just go through this again. The Snellen's acuity chart, it measures distance central acuity. This was designed by Dr. Hermann Snellen in 1862. So Dr. Hermann Snellen was the friend of Dr. Donders. And Dr. Donders, he used to diagnose the visual conditions of his patients by making them look at charts on his wall. So he requested Dr. Snellen to come up with a standard chart. So now the patient could benefit by going to any doctor, and then they could go to the same optician for glasses. Now, what are optotypes? They are symbols and letters that are used in the visual acuity chart. The chart usually has 8 to 9 lines. And as you can see, they are black in color against a white background. They are all block letters. And they have the sans serif fonts. So what are these sans serif fonts? If you look at the figure below, you can see the one on the left has these extensions, whereas the one on the right is without extensions. So the one without extensions, the simpler one is called as the sans serif, whereas the other one is called slab serif font. Now all these fonts are equally legible. Now, a very important thing to note here is the number of letters varies in different lines. The first line has one letter, the second line has two letters, last line has eight letters. And they also have a non-uniform decrease in the size of the letters from top to bottom. Now, another thing to note here is that the spacing between the lines is fixed and the chart is evenly illuminated. Now, let's understand each octotype. So, each letter is designed to fit. Each letter is designed to fit a 5x5 square. So the thickness of the dark lines and the thickness of the gap in between them is equal. The height and the width of the letter is 5 times the thickness of the constituent line. At a given distance, each letter subtends an angle of 5 minutes at the nodal point. And each small square, so you can see this, each small square or the thickness of the constituent line subtends an angle of 1 minute at the nodal point of the eye. So you can see that all these letters will subtend an angle of 5 minutes at the nodal point of the eye. Now, why do you need to construct an octotype? Does the size and the distance of the letter matter? So yes, of course. If you see this large E, it cannot come here. The small E cannot go here. That is because each octotype has to subtend an angle of 5 minutes at the nodal point here. Now, how do we calculate this? By this formula. Okay, you can see on the left-hand side, where W is the octotype height or the width, D is the distance from the eye to the chart, and theta is the angle that is subtended by the octotype, and it is 5 minutes. Now, these are different types of Snellen's chart. You can see on the left side, the half-size charts at 3 meters, and they subtend the same angle. You also have the reverse charts that are projected and viewed in the mirror. So nowadays, space is a constraint. So we tend to use these more often. Visual acuity at any distance can be calculated by using letter size in M units. And nowadays, for our local use, we have standardized charts in various regional languages. We're all familiar with the pinhole. So the principle is, it allows only the central undeviated rays of light to form a clear image on the retina. The peripheral rays, as you can see, get blocked. Now, this helps to differentiate if the reduced visual acuity is due to media opacity or refractive error. So when vision improves with pinhole, it's likely to be due to refractive errors. So usually the size used is 1.2 millimeters. However, it can vary from 1 to 2 millimeters. But if it's very small, that's less than 0.9 mm, then it tends to cause diffraction, loss of resolution, and limitation of illumination. So this is a useful tool for, as a useful screening tool for best corrected visual acuity. Now the procedure of testing. So the person stands at a distance of 6 meters or 20 feet from the chart. What is the reason? That's because the rays of light have minimum divergence at this distance and it exerts minimal accommodation. So they are almost parallel. Now the ambient illumination. If you're using illuminated charts, then the room has to be lit dimly. If you use non-illuminated charts, like sometimes we do in camps, then the chart has to be in the sun and the patient is seated in the shade. We always test one eye at a time and then preferably both eyes together. Take care not to press on the eye like is being done here. It's good to use a trial frame and a block. Now you start reading the chart from above till you can read the finest line and then repeat this for the other eye, and also with pinhole and with spectacle corrections. Now, how do we denote this? It is in the form of Snellen's fraction. So in the numerator, we have the distance at which the patient is standing from the chart. And in the denominator, it is the distance at which a person with normal vision can see the optotype. So when a person has a visual acuity of 6/6, it represents his ability or ability of his eye to have a resolution of 1 minute of. Now let's take this example. When the vision is 624, 6 is the distance of the subject in meters from the vision chart. And 24 is the distance in meters at which the person with normal vision sees the same optotype. At least 5 out of 6 letters have to be read to be denoted as a Snellen's fraction. Now, what do you do if a patient is only partially reading the chart? In that case, you record the vision of the previous line, which he reads fully, and then add the number of letters read in the subsequent line. So for example, if he reads the 612 line completely and 2 letters of the next line, so you represent the visual acuity as 6/12 and add 2 to that. Now what happens if the person can't read the topmost letter? He keeps moving towards it 1 meter at a time, and then you change the notation. For example, now the distance is 5 meters. So if he reads the topmost letter at 5 meters, it is 5/60. So keep moving ahead meter by meter. You can go right up to 1 meter away from the chart. So this is what will happen. And once he comes to 1 meter and he's still not able to read the topmost letter, then you have to try finger counting. And if that is also not, he's not able to perceive that, then you try hand movements. You shake your, move your hands in front of the eyes. Sometimes you might even need to illuminate the eyes so patient can see better if he has poor vision. And you denote it as hand movement positive. Now, if he's not able to perceive that also, then you need to check if he has perception of light. How do you do that? You can use a bright torch. And if he sees with that, it's well and good. But if he is not able to perceive light with the torch, then it's you have to use the brightest illumination available, which is the indirect ophthalmoscope. And you try at least 8 to 10 times before you're sure he says he's not able to see. In case perception of light is positive, check for projection of rays. So you direct the torch in all 4 quadrants. The patient has to point out towards the direction of the light. Suppose you're shining the light from below, and so that will project to the superior retina. And if he's not able to localize that, then you know that the PR is inaccurate in the superior retina. Now there are different expressions of the Snellen's acuity. So the metric units is 20/20, where 6/6 is expressed as 20/20. 6/30 is represented as 20/100. Then you have the decimal acuity, which is nothing but the 20/20 or the metric units expressed in decimals. So a 20/100 would be 0.2. You also have the logarithm of the reciprocal of Snellen's. So 20/20 represented as log 0, 20/100 represented as log score 0.7. Now, logarithm of, when we talk about logMAR acuity or logarithm of minimum angle of resolution, there it helps to know some basics, which we have probably forgotten from earlier. So let's now understand what this geometric progression is. So you see these numbers, 1, 2, 4, 8. The previous number differs from the next one by a common ratio. Here it's 2. Now, 2 to the power of 3 is 8 here, where 2 is the base and 3 is the component. So the logarithm of 8 to the base 2 is 3. Commonly used base is 10, or what we call as log 10. We don't even have to say 10. When you say log, it's understood. So here the logarithm of 100 to the base 10 is 2. So logs are really shorthand for exponents. Now, negative log, like here, 10 to the power of minus 3 is 1 by 10 into 10 into 10, represented as 0.001. The log of 1 to the base 10 is 0. Therefore, 1 minute angle subtended has a log mar score of 0. For 2 minute angle subtended, the log mar score is 0.3. The log of 2 to the base 10 is 0.3. So I hope we have got a slight revision of this. Now coming to the logmar acuity chart. Very interestingly to note here, every line, every single line has 5 octotypes. They are square in shape. The letters in each line, they are all of the same size. And the space between them is constant, which is equal to the size of the letter. The size of the letters of every row, now I'm talking of the row, it increases in a progressive manner. And this is by a constant or a fixed constant or a common ratio. We studied that just now in geometric progression, right? So here the common ratio is 1.2589 or 0.1 log unit. It is the same for space in between the rows. That means the space also you can see logarithmically increases between the rows. So it's important to note here that each single letter has a value, 0.02 log units. The total score per line is 5 into 0.02, which represents a change of 0.1 log units. How do we score this? There are several methods. I'm mentioning two of them. So you start from the letter above, letters at the top, and you come down until he cannot read a minimum of 3 letters. And the score, it is scored by number of letters correctly identified, and you multiply the number by 0.02. The second method is you note the score of the last row where all the 5 letters are read. Then you subtract 0.02 log units for every letter beyond the last row. For example, if he reached the 20-30 row completely, then note the value 0.2. And then in the next row, if he reads 2 letters, you multiply that by 0.02 and you get a value of 0.04. Now you subtract 0.04 from 0.2 to get a visual acuity score of 0.2. So let's just revise the difference between the two charts. So logmar obviously is a much better method to assess. So there is uniform progression in space between the lines. And the space in case of Snellen's we saw earlier was fixed. There are equal numbers of letter in each row in logmar, and there's a uniform progression in letter size, whereas there are unequal number of letters in different rows of Snellen's. The difficulty level is equal or more equal in case of logmar than Snellen's. And logmar, the score is indicated by total number of letters read. What happens in Snellen's is there's a jump effect at different levels. For example, if you're reading 6 by 36 and you can't read one letter, it definitely matters. Whereas in the 6-9 line, if he doesn't read one letter, it really doesn't affect. His vision is still 6-9. So this is a worldwide standard, and visual acuity was recorded following PRP in diabetic retinopathy in the ETDRS studies. So the visual angle doubles every three lines, what was quantified as moderate visual loss, and quadruples every six lines, what was quantified as severe visual loss. And in this particular model of the ETDRS, the light level remains constant, is calibrated, and it is held constant throughout. So it's very standardized. Now coming to the near vision charts. Near vision charts always require good illumination, and it's good for the illumination to come above the patient's left shoulder. Again, you test one eye at a time and then both eyes together. First is the Jaeger's chart. So this consisted of just ordinary printer's fonts of varying sizes. So there was nothing great about the geometry of these letters. And they were marked from 1 to 7. And you see how it is represented, that is J2. And you also mentioned the distance. Now, since this was not so good, the Faculty of Ophthalmologists of Great Britain, they standardized the font. They standardized it to the Times Roman font, and they also standardized the spacing. So this is recorded as whatever, N5, and it goes till N48. So near vision is like, for example, he reads the N8 line. So you mention it as N8 at 33 centimeters. It's, you have to mention the distance. Now this is the Snellen's near vision chart. Okay, it's the Snellen's equivalent for near vision. So this is a photographic reduction of the distance chart, wherein the thickness of the letters is 1/17th that of the distance vision letters. And the 6/6 equivalent here subtends an angle of 5 minutes of an arc with the chart at 33 centimeters. It's apparently not very popular. Now coming to this section of visual acuity testing in children, very important, very commonly asked in examinations, especially theory exams. Now, there are so many tests that are available, and I possibly couldn't go into the finer nuances of each one. What I thought I'll do is just, you know, highlight on the principles of these tests. It's important to know the visual development here. So you see, by 8 weeks, and then it progresses up to 12 weeks, the fixation and following of light and also target. And there's also development of the social smiles. By 3 months, the child develops binocular vision and coordinated eye movements. So that's why when you have these random eye movements, before 3 months of age, we wait before we rush to diagnose them. By 4 to 9 months, visually directed reaching develops, and it coincides with the motor milestone of pincer grasp. So the child is going to, he goes to sort of towards the target to fetch things. And then by 2 years, picture matching the child can do. By 3 years, letter matching, but of single optotypes, the simple one. And by 5 years, he should be able to more or less do what an adult does. So Snellen's chart matching or naming can happen by this time. So this is an approximate age and the visual acuity at that age. I'm saying approximate because it can change depending upon what you use to measure it. That is the method of testing. So by 2 years, usually they develop 6/6 vision. Now here is the conceptual slide. When children less than 3 years, they cannot verbalize. That means they cannot say, this is a car, this is an apple, this is a house. They also cannot match the symbols. And they're definitely not able to identify letters or symbols. So how do we measure vision in such small children? So what we do is we present a stimulus or a grating, dark and white bands, and we observe their movements. that is the eye movements or electrophysiologic response to them. Mind you, here we generally check resolution and not recognition. That's why we might overestimate the visual acuity and we might miss amblyopia. When you test children more than 3 years, that is the preschool age, now they are a little better at verbalizing. They can match simple objects. Okay, they can identify simple letters and symbols. But we can use only limited ones here. And when children are more than 6 years, you can use the Snellen's and the ETDRS charts. So this is just a simple representation. In infants, we can use fixation preference, visual evoke potential, force preferential looking. And in 3 to 5 years, we use limited symbols like case chart, Cardiff, the Lee symbols. And then in older children, Snellen's and ETDRS. So in infants, we can use the fixation preference. Now, this is clinically most useful to detect amblyopia, and it indirectly tells us about the visual acuity. So fixation preference can be under monocular conditions as in squint, or under binocular conditions when the eyes are straight. So in monocular conditions, if a child has squint and always prefers to fix with one eye, then we can infer that the vision in the non-preferred or the squinting eye is poor. And if it freely alternates, that's if fixation freely alternates, then you can assume that the vision is almost equal. So these tests that are performed under binocular conditions are more sensitive because you can compare the vision between the two eyes, and it also helps to detect amblyopia when the children have normal central vision. Monocular, the tests under monocular conditions are done first. So we do the CSM, that is we check if the fixation is central, that is if it's foveal, if it's steady, that there is no nystagmus, and the quality of vision, that it is maintained. So when the eyes are straight, the children could still have a fixation preference and mild amblyopia or a difference in visual acuity. So what we do here is we induce a strabismus with a vertical prism, and then we test for the fixation preference like I mentioned earlier. We prefer a vertical prism because a horizontal prism, if they have more of this fusional vergence, then they can probably fuse. That's difficult with the vertical versional fusional vergence, which is more limited. So force preferential looking tests, the examples here are the optokinetic nystagmus drum and VEP. So here, this we usually start using it after 6 months of age. And what we do here is we induce a nystagmus by rotating the drum. So the finer the grating that the child responds to, the better is the vision. So this is the simple principle behind it. And in visual evoked response, this is an objective method to assess vision. So we give a visual stimulus, either it could be a flash or it could be a pattern, the squares, alternate dark and light squares, and record the brain activity that is in the occipital cortex with the help of the leads. And we use the flash stimulus for if we want to know the health of the optic nerve and the visual system. Pattern reversal is used for visual acuity. So the finer the stimuli to which it responds, the better is the visual acuity. So these are the Teller cards. So these are high contrast grating. Now, we are checking the form sense, right? So it always, when you present a homogeneous and a non-homogeneous back, stimuli, so the child will always prefer to fix at the non-homogeneous stimuli. So this is the basis of the test. So the examiner here is seated behind the screen. The examiner doesn't know on which side of the grating is there on the chart. So, and he keeps regularly flipping, you know, 180 degrees. And he tries to observe through the hole, or sometimes you need to peep over the chart and see. Sometimes practically it's good to have another person standing behind, because at times it can get very difficult to assess. And this is very time consuming, so seldom done in routine clinical practice. And older children get distracted very easily. So this is more easily done in very young children. The Lee symbol chart. This is almost like a gold standard that is used. Now, the advantages of this optotypes is, this has advantages of both optotypes and pictures. So what happens here is they can match as well as they can identify. So you have both resolution as well as recognition here. Now these charts are standardized, and they can be named even by a two-year-old. So these are just four symbols, and they're so simple. There's a house, there's an apple, and there's a circle and a square. The lines are graded in steps of 0.1 log unit. The test distance is 3 meters, and it is very accurate. It's the closest to the Snellen's visual acuity, and it also has high sensitivity for amblyopia. So here, what you have to do is first familiarize the child with each of these symbols. If the child is verbalizing, try to understand how he calls a particular object. For example, a child may call a car as truck. So you must know that he actually understands what it is, but not able to give the right word. So if he is able to verbalize, it's very easy. He'll tell you what that is. In case he can't verbalize, then you see the charts, these cards on the right side, there with the child and the mother. And then when you show one symbol, he tries to match the same in the card that he's having. So this is how you perform the test. These are the Cardiff acuity charts. Now, as you can see, you have two dark lines, and in between those lines is the white area. So these are very large picture optotypes. They are all of the same size, and they are visible only at a particular distance or closer to it. That means if you move further away, they vanish. So they are called as vanishing optotypes. This tends to overestimate the visual acuity. Probably it stimulates a larger area, you know, beyond the fovea. So that's why I said earlier, you know, we might say the child has a particular visual acuity, but it varies because some charts tend to overestimate acuity, and we may get a better acuity in them. So they are not really comparable when you compare it by different methods of examination. This is the case picture test. So this also has easily recognizable optotypes performed at 3 meters. And here also you can identify or match them. Now you must remember, when a child with nystagmus comes to you and you want to check his vision, when you occlude one eye and you're testing the vision may be worse with complete occlusion, because the latent nystagmus may become manifest. So when you test vision in such children, you can use a small plus lens or a translucent occluder in one eye while testing, so that the nystagmus gets dampened and you have a better assessment of visual acuity. In case there's a null point, then you have to check vision with and definitely with and without head posture. In case of children with amblyopia, especially if they're not able to verbalize, etc., then this fixation preference will help you in the management. You can see how they are improving to patching treatment. And keep in mind the crowding phenomenon, that is, single optotypes tend to overestimate visual acuity. So now, again, coming back to the components of vision. We always, as I mentioned, talk about visual acuity, visual acuity, visual acuity, forgetting there are so many more aspects to vision. Let me repeat. Contrast sensitivity being very important, then stereopsis, visual field, color vision, etc. So we come to our next topic, that is contrast sensitivity. And as you can see, this picture beautifully brings out the contrast sensitivity. Now, all of you must have come across in your clinical practice or in day-to-day OPD. Okay, you might see there are patients who have very little cataract and yet they are dissatisfied with their vision. And you might have observed children who have monocular cataract. So immediately after cataract surgery, they are not bouncy kids. They are still, you know, withdrawn. But once you treat them with patching, you suddenly change, see the change in them. They become very active. That means they have got something more than visual acuity, which has changed a lot for them. Then you will also see the effect in old people who suddenly are feeling very embarrassed because they cannot recognize other people's faces. And then because of that, they become introverts. At times in your own clinical practice, you're wondering, is this a case of optic neuritis or this is AION? So contrast sensitivity has something in common with all these conditions. Let's understand the quantity and qualitative aspect of vision. Visual quantity is determined by patient's visual acuity and visual field. Visual quality describes how well he can perform vision-related activities. So visual quality helps the ophthalmologist to understand how the patient is able to use his vision for his regular activities like reading, mobility, employment, and activities of daily living. So contrast sensitivity is created by the difference in luminance. It's very obvious what luminance is in this picture. So by the difference in luminance from two adjacent surfaces, there are no definitive borders to these surfaces. The image on this side, you can see the difference, okay, with less contrast and more contrast. With more contrast, you see these areas are darker and the brighter areas are brighter. So we are able to have a better view and understanding of the picture. So the minimum contrast that is required to see an object is called contrast threshold. Now, if I can see an object with very little contrast, then my threshold is low. And when my threshold is low, naturally, my sensitivity is high. So you see they have a reciprocal relation. There are two types of contrast sensitivity, that is temporal and spatial. Let me simplify this for you. So spatial frequency means you're measuring it per unit distance or even angle. So you can see on the left-hand side, the first figure, there are so many dark and white bands, right? Now, if you compare it to the right side, you will see that the number of lines are lesser and the space between them is more. So this is what spatial frequency is. It's high frequency on the left side because there are more gratings per unit distance. And here it is less because less unit or less gratings per unit distance. So this is spatial frequency. In temporal frequency, we talk in terms of per unit time, that is number of flickers per unit time. So here the time is constant. You see the number of flickers here and compare it to this. So obviously this is less. So here the temporal frequency is lower, here it is higher. And usually in contrast, it's the spatial frequency that we commonly use. So how is it tested? So we use sine wave gratings, where there's a gradual change in contrast. So can you see here? And here also you can see these edges are blurred. Whereas in case of square wave grating, there's a sudden change in contrast. They are very sharp edges. So there are three variables in the measurement of contrast sensitivity. One is luminance, that is how bright the light is, how much black the dark is in contrast to the white, and then the distance between the grating period, or what we call as cycles per degree visual angle. So one cycle is the space you can see here between two bars. So measuring unit of spatial frequency is cycles per degree. So when we say it is 30 cycles per degree, that means there are 30 bars and gaps in 1 degree. So contrast sensitivity tests, they use sine wave gratings as targets instead of the letter optotypes that we studied earlier. The observer is presented with the sine wave grating target of a given spatial frequency, that is the cycles per degree is fixed. And the contrast of the target grating is varied. And then you check the observer's contrast detecting threshold. And the reciprocal of the threshold is the contrast sensitivity function. So I told you about the reciprocal relationship of threshold and sensitivity. So this is very similar to how we test hearing. In hearing, we change the decibels and the frequency and test the threshold hearing. Whereas here we are changing the contrast and the spatial frequency and determining the threshold for vision. Now, other factors which affect contrast sensitivity? Yes, the luminance, target size of the pupil, refractive errors, opacities, the grating shape, and also motion. Now, there are different tests. Some are letter tests, some are grating charts. There are so many of them, I possibly can't explain each one in detail. So let me brief upon Pelli-Robson, which I think is commonly used. So this is the Pelli-Robson contrast sensitivity chart. So this uses triplets. That means three letters together. So you have, so this is one triplet. So each triplet fades by 0.08 log units. Okay? This is important to understand. We perform this test at a distance of 1 meter and with a standard external illumination. You have to wear a spectacle correction and then you check this monocularly and binocularly and you can score it. So there are different levels of contrast loss, okay? So you can grade it. If they're able to read 6 to 7 lines, 6 to 7 lines means you multiply it by 2, 6 to 2s are 12, they are 12 triplets. Moderate vision loss means if he is able to read 4 to 5 lines, in severe vision loss, he can read only 1 line, the big one on top. So this is how you record and interpret the chart. See, for example, right eye 1.70 log contrast sensitivity. So for right eye, left eye, and both. So normally between the age of 20 to 50 years, it's around 1.80 log contrast sensitivity units. And the binocular one is slightly a 0.05 log units more than the monocular value. This is the example, this is a Marsh letter contrast sensitivity test. Now it's pretty similar to Pelli-Robson. These are near charts. And here, this is more sensitive because you see each letter fades by 0.04 log units. There it was 0.08. Okay, so it's more precise. Here the testing distance is lesser, 50 centimeters. Now depending on the number of letters read, they are given a score and graded. So this scoring is more precise for this. So it's slightly better than the Pelli-Robson chart. Now you can also use gradings, like I mentioned earlier. You have the Arden's grading, then the Cambridge test, and the Melbourne test. There are so many of them. You can read up more in detail if you're interested. So here you just have to, you know, see these gradings. In this particular one, each row has a different spatial frequency. So you will see more bars in one and less bars. And also, the contrast also reduces with each letter in the row. It's very obvious. You see the number of bars are also changing and it's becoming lighter and lighter. Now the subject has to identify the grating. That means, is it vertical or is it 15 degrees to the right or 15 degrees to the left? Okay. Anti-clockwise or clockwise. So what are the uses of testing contrast sensitivity? So if you want to know or understand the magnification needs, it also helps us understand the illumination needs, ability to use optical magnification devices, because if the contrast is very poor, you may not be able to give them, they cannot efficiently use those devices. And also it will tell you about the overall visual function of the person. So if the contrast sensitivity is less, then you need to increase the magnification. You can also increase the illumination and increase the contrast and thereby improve his contrast sensitivity function. So let me elaborate again. What are the difficulties the people face? Because these happen so often, yet we really don't give too much importance to contrast sensitivity. So see their difficulties. Driving at night is difficult. Judging distances is difficult. Walking down steps, because you can't make out where the edge is ending and the next surface beginning. So the elderly are put at a risk of falls. Difficult to recognize faces, and particularly in old people, they want to read their prescriptions. They want to read print on their bottles, on their tablets. It becomes difficult with low contrast sensitivity. So you can see now how by changing the temperature of light, we can improve their sensitivity. So now a person who used to love reading books can go back to his books, because maybe he stopped that and went to gardening because he could no longer read. So you can just change this and help him get back to his reading habits. And this is very important. Can you see the contrast, the color coding of the steps? Very important in elderly to prevent falls. You can also help by giving them magnifiers. And simple things like that. Here it's about food. So, you know, if you improve the contrast between the placing mats on the table and the plate, or the plate and the bowl, it makes life so much easier for them. Just a few more points. So contrast sensitivity, it decreases with age. That's around 10% with each decade. The fovea is sensitive to higher frequencies and the peripheral retina to lower frequencies. So you want to test the peripheral retinal functions. You can use lower frequencies, so it becomes easier to test. And refractive errors generally affect higher frequencies. Early lenticular changes affect lower frequencies. And it helps us very clinically also. So contrast sensitivity is affected in diseases of the optic nerve, glaucoma, amblyopia, visual pathway lesions, and diabetes. So like I said earlier, there is we want to know if there is optic neuritis or AION. Then we need to, once we do the contrast sensitivity, if we know if it is affected, then yes, we know that it is optic neuritis. So to summarize, vision is so much more than just visual acuity. Logmar acuity is a better way to assess visual acuity than Snellen's. Visual acuity testing depends on age, what test we use. So the optotype letters are useful for older children, and in very young children, we use their motor we observe their motor or electrophysiologic responses to grating stimuli and then have an assessment of visual acuity in them. And remember, contrast sensitivity is one of the most important functions of vision. I'd like to reiterate this for PGs especially. It's not just hard work, but it's sustained hard work that makes you successful. And I thank you for your patient hearing.
Thank you, Sheetal. That was very nice. We have several questions for you. Mrutika has collected all the questions and she'll ask you.
Yeah, I'll just...
I hope I can answer them.
Very.
Yes, ma'am. Okay, so the first one is, can you explain about vernier acuity?
See, that is what we call hyperacuity. When the arc is lesser than 1 minute, so that helps us. You just make out the difference in, if you're able to appreciate that difference in alignment, then, you know, you can say that the patient has hyperacuity. So these are available in the charts which you can use.
Okay. What is the ideal distance for measuring finger counting and for hand movement?
Finger counting close to face, there's nothing like ideal. So most of the books do not say there's an ideal distance, and hand movements is just close to face. You need to create that motion. Only if he's not able to see well, you can shine a torch on the palm so that he can see better.
Okay. So the next question is on pinholes. What is the difference between a single pinhole and the one with multiple pinholes? And what is a super pinhole?
Okay, in multiple pinholes, what happens is, let's say a patient has lenticular opacity. So there are areas which are clear and areas which are not clear. So when you use a pinhole with multiple holes, so there is a chance it will pass through the clear area and form a clear image. So that is the use. So you need to dilate ideally the pupil and use this. So that's how it's used. Super pinhole, I don't seem to remember. I will get back to them if they mail me. I'll find that out.
No, it is just the way of assessing potential acuity. If potential acuity meter is not available, then you use super pinhole. It's an optometry.
Okay. That is called as potential pinhole acuity, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah, I can explain this. See, what happens is at times when we don't have this potential acuity meter, you use a near vision chart. Okay, this is in a patient with media cataract or media opacity. And you put good illumination on the chart. So it has to be brightly lit. And then you use a pinhole and try to see if through the clear areas of the lens, he's able to see the acuity chart, how well he can see or which are the finest letters he can see. Depending on that, you can give him a visual prognosis. So that is
Also one more way to do it is they attach a five adapter lens to that pinhole, and hold the near vision chart at 40
centimeters.
Millimeters. 40 centimeters. So that is how they test it. So that is called what they're asking actually.
PAP, it is called potential acuity.
Yeah. So in the absence vision. Of a potential acuity meter, this is used by optometrists.
Yes.
All right, next question is, when do you check for projection of rays? For instance, if a patient has 6x60 vision, do you check for it? And what is the minimum vision for a patient for checking projection of rays?
Okay, projection of rays, people with hand movements also we can check. Those with only PL also we can check. So that tells you the function of the peripheral retina. So... yes, I don't know if there is any particular vision when you suspect. Usually when, you know, it's hand movements and PL, we tend to check.
Yeah, even in patients who have 6x6 vision, they may have inaccurate PR if they have just a, you know, central visual field left. Especially in patients who have retinitis pigmentosa and advanced glaucoma, they might have lost their peripheral field of vision. So visual acuity does not really matter when you want to test, projection of rays. It is the disease that you're suspecting that matters. And of course, in all low vision conditions, you have to test PR.
Yeah. peripheral retinal functions.
So when we represent the projection of rays, is it the visual field that we are representing, or is it the part of the retina?
The retina.
All right. So the next question is there any specific reason why for near vision the illumination is over the left shoulder of a patient?
No, basically you need good illumination. They say it's nice if it can come. So you have to be able to see it. See, like distance, visual acuity for projection charts, we need dim illumination. So this is just to reiterate the fact that you need good lighting when you check near vision.
What do you call as an amblyopic age group?
That is, generally we say 6 to 8 years, but now I think it's even more because maybe you expect some marginal improvement. So generally 6 to 8 years is what we call as amblyopic age group, because there is still the visual plasticity and you can reverse it to a large extent. The earlier you intervene, the better chances of restoring vision to as close normal as possible.
What distance do you check for OKN?
OKN distance, I don't know, sir, do you know the exact distance?
I try to remember.
They just hold it near, I don't seem to remember the exact number. Maybe 40 centimeters or a meter or so. I'll have to check it up.
All right. Is there any cutoff value for low contrast when we designate it as a low contrast?
See, low contrast, like I said, it depends on age. Okay, so every decade there's a 10% loss. So if you if it's around 50 years of age, then around 1.85 is normal. So something which is much lower than that will obviously be abnormal. So you have to consider it, what is the normal for that age, and then decide whether it's low.
Is there any difference when you place an IOL or a spectacle lens on contrast sensitivity?
Spectacle lens or?
Or any IOL, intraocular lens after, does it affect?
I guess there is a very marginal this thing. But I can say for after cataracts, PCOs can definitely affect contrast. And I guess the quality of IOL probably also contributes to some extent to contrast sensitivity.
Okay, the next question is, can you give the uses of prisms for testing visual acuity?
Yes. For fixation, like I was talking about the vertical prism test, right? So you can use it. See, here the concept is you want to see if the eye is amblyogenic or no. And if it is amblyopic, that means there is fixation preference that is demonstrated. And the non-fixing eye has less vision. So what you can do is, especially when the eyes are straight, use a vertical prism, induce a strabismus, and then study the fixation pattern. If they show a fixation pattern, that means some amount of visual loss is there in the other eye.
All right, ma'am. I think we have covered most of the questions.
Okay, time
up. There might be something on Facebook or YouTube. Can you just...
We've covered those, sir.
Okay, fine. So, OKN is 60 centimeters.
60, okay. I didn't remember the exact value. Thank you, sir.
That's it. Anything else? You have any questions?
Me?
No, Namratika.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. That was really a wonderful lecture, and it explained everything in a simplified way for everyone.
Yeah. And the entire lecture will be available on YouTube and Facebook. And the next lecture will be by Dr. Krishna Prasad, and he'll be talking about clinical optics and refraction. So that will be an interesting set of 4 lectures starting from next Wednesday for 2 weeks continuously. So you'll have 4 lectures which are going to be very interactive. So please read up and come so that you can ask him a lot of questions. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye.